Yeah, just to say also, there is a lot of detail on some of the policy points that were being mentioned in the report. I think on the active search element, there's an interesting resonance from the Benazir support program in Pakistan and Harris Gazdar's work, which has a similar methodology with a lot of the same lessons. So, as Layla...
she's just popped out.
Right. All right, let me quickly introduce the panel then and ask you, as I said, to hold questions and thoughts for the general discussion later. Start with Ricardo Fuentes-Neva. It's great to have you here, Ricardo. Ricardo is head of research for Oxfam GB and manages a team delivering research in support of Oxfam's global campaigns and also operational effectiveness at the country level. I've already introduced Leandro. Layla? Yeah. Gerard Howe, it's a pleasure to have you here, Gerard. Gerard is an ex-colleague of mine in the social development group at DFID some years ago. He's recently taken up the post of head of DFID's civil society department in policy division, which also has responsibility for policy and programming on civil society, girls and women, gender, faith, youth, LGBT issues, disability, and violence against women. And Gerard has worked for DFID since 1998 with a mix of country posts and policy posts. So welcome, Gerard. And it's a very great pleasure to introduce Naila Kabeer. It was, before you arrived, Naila, your 2010 report was mentioned several times, which was the origins of this work and of the intersecting inequalities framework as used here. And Naila is currently Professor of Gender and Development at the London School of Economics. And before that, she was Professor of Development and SOAS, and then for many years before that, of course, Professor and Senior Fellow at IDS Sussex. And finally, I think all this work in many ways started with Layla Saad, and it's a great pleasure to introduce Layla. Layla, her current position is with the World Centre for Sustainable Development in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, which is a partnership between the government of Brazil and the UN. But in a previous incarnation, Layla led the MDG Fund inequality work and was heavily involved in the commissioning of this. So it's lovely. It's nice to have you here, Layla. You're very welcome. Okay, the first question I'd like to kick off with, Naila, there's a very strong narrative running through this work that the MDGs were not really fit for purpose in terms of addressing the situation of the most marginalised, the most excluded, and people who suffer from intersecting inequalities. Would you like to just give us a restatement of that to kick off the discussion around the link with the Sustainable Development Goals? What were the deficiencies in the MDG framework?
I think there were a number of deficiencies. One, of course, and the one most widely recognized, is the extent to which the targets and indicators of the MDGs were expressed as averages and proportions, which of course means that by reaching out for the lowest hanging fruit, you will look like you have achieved what you set out to achieve, but in fact the highest hanging fruit are still left untouched. So I think one was that. Second, I think, and I have recently done some work on trying to track the gender politics behind the MDGs and beyond, and what struck me is very much the very ad hoc way in which the MDGs were put together. So that translation from the Millennium Statement to the Millennium Development Goals, which then became like the world's biggest promise, was actually really literally cooked up by a group of UN bureaucrats who put on the agenda what they knew best, and therefore the analysis behind these goals, you know, what links them up and so on, was never addressed. And the focus was very much on a multidimensional notion of poverty, but not on inequality. So as we know, inequality was mentioned in relation to gender without acknowledging that women are differentiated by caste, class, and so on. Inequality was touched on in the first goal, but in terms of, you know, maternal mortality, health, etc., no attention was paid to those that are hardest to reach. So I think in that sense, the MDGs encouraged almost a business as usual type approach.
Thanks very much, Naila. Ricardo, you've been looking, I think, at inequality recently and the difference it might have made had there been an inequality goal looking backwards. Do you have any thoughts at this point on how the MDG framework played out?
Yeah, I think, I mean, just to build on what Naila was saying, I think one of the limitations of the MDG framework was that it was mostly a technocratic, technical vision that was, I mean, the underlying idea was that there was a poverty trap, and if you kind of like pushed enough in different indicators, different sectors, then you would have a virtuous cycle that would generate development as such. And I think, I think that neglected the issue of institutions and the issue of the relation of power, which this report highlights a lot. And I really like the political element of this report, and it's very brave being a report signed off by the UN to talk about elites and these kind of things. So I think that's a limitation. But now we know that institutions are important, that institutions are key to build what we consider inclusive societies. And the question is, like, how do we generate the moments that allow for these changes to occur? And I think that's kind of the big question. I think we live in a very particular historical moment where we've seen the concentration of income and wealth increase over the past 35 years. It's been a trend that has been constant since the early 1980s. So the report that we launched at the beginning of the year shows that the 85 richest people own as much wealth as the bottom half of the population, and showing that that's increasing. The new Credit Suisse report came out a couple of weeks ago and shows that it's been increasing. Kind of intersects with this trend, because then what you have is, if this is about power relations, and what the report is showing is that a lot of the progress comes from contestation of power, then what happens when you have more and more concentration of income and wealth? How does that limit the contestation of power that allows this inclusive society? And the other thing that we see more and more is the closing down of civil society space around the world, which again kind of like plays to the argument presented earlier. So basically summarizing, the MDGs did not capture that. If we don't start discussing these elements right now very, very explicitly in the context of the SDGs, we might be missing the boat on the next 15 years. So congratulations to the authors for being brave and talking about politics, talking about elites, talking about this like very important dynamic between different groups. We need to understand more how the moments occur that allow for Brazil to implement these policies, and I think the danger in the SDG context is that if we look too hard on targets and things that can be measured, we might just miss it, you know. I'm not saying that measuring is not important. Measuring is extremely important. Part of the reason why the bottom 5% has not shown in, like, as much progress is because it's basically uncounted. But I mean, we shouldn't also only focus on things that can be measured. So those are kind of my initial points.
That's great. Thanks very much, Ricardo. Gerard, if we're thinking about now, this range of issues around the MDGs that can be seen as deficiencies, but we're also thinking about what needs to be different, what needs to change for the next goal set. The Sustainable Development Goal framework is likely to be obviously the main elements of that. How would you see the key changes that would need to occur for the poorest and most excluded groups to clearly benefit from that?
And I mean, a lot of this also stems from Naila and Ricardo's analysis going forwards, right? Yeah. This lack of politics, this focus on aid as a driver of development, right? This focus on sort of the fact that you could have a technocratic approach in a political context and how to move those forward. I mean, I think we're really struck by the political power of Leave No One Behind. Now, we can debate about ambition and realism and those sorts of things, but as a clarion call, you know, the world's biggest promise, now that is a great big promise that we could make here. And I think it's up to us to think about how one translates that promise through and thinks about it in political ways that actually do drive change in local context and national context going forward. So I think that's extremely important. I was really struck as well, Andy, by your blog on just when you look at the SDG framework together at the moment, the scale of that ambition, the scale of the change in terms of its reach, its proper global inclusion for the first time, and what we want to have in there. So we recognise we've got to think about that really carefully. It's right that we've got to focus on eradicating extreme poverty. That's absolutely right. It's right that we look at those things we didn't achieve through the MDGs. So if you like, that first top half that really is about generating that further progress. But everything the report says, and that Naila and Ricardo have said, is that politics and institutions really matter. And thinking about the incentives and the ways in which you can generate those to create differences in inequality and identity-based politics, essentially, is really important. And that's, I think, where some of the bottom end come in. And certainly when we look at 10 and 16 at the moment, they're speaking to that. The question is the degree to which they're able to actually generate those incentives, to which they are based in national processes exactly of contestation. And that is a real issue for us. I think, Ricardo, you're right. Data, data, data. I was very struck by actually starting to get at some of that data is going to be critical. So being able to count at least better than we have been before is really critical. I was at a conference last week on disability data, and actually just six simple questions into national censuses can expose a level of inequality that perhaps we weren't able to get at before. So some of that sort of pragmatic approach is really important too.
Right. Thanks very much, Gerard. Layla, coming back to this work from where you sit now, looking at sustainable development in Brazil, and thinking about the SDGs going forward, what do you think about the realism of the notion that setting global goals and targets can actually have an influence on processes that happen at the national level, the sort of social and political processes that the report discusses?
I think there's several things. I just wanted to start by saying just a couple of words also about the motivation behind starting this work in the first place. And I think, obviously, it touches on your first question about the MDGs and whether the MDGs were sort of fit for purpose. And I think that after having worked for several years on MDG-related projects at the national level and seeing that no matter how many projects you can implement, it seems like the same people are always going to be left out, and they're not necessarily, you might achieve some progress in a specific project, but if you don't address the more sort of structural issues of why people are in that situation to begin with, then you can keep running projects all your life. So the whole aid industry will be happy, but, it won't necessarily make a big difference at the national level. So I think that was one of the, one of the motivating factors behind doing this kind of analysis in the MDGs. But I think it's also important to understand, obviously, and this kind of work shows that, is that people are left out because of structural discrimination and because of unequal balances in power. And I don't think that necessarily, the MDGs were obviously not even designed to address those issues. So yeah. In retrospect, of course, we can bash the MDGs, but they weren't even thought of to do that. Was not their intent. They were very much sort of poverty focused and left out a series of issues that we're touching on today. But I think that, no matter how right you get a global framework, how many perfect words and principles you put in there, it doesn't necessarily mean it's going to happen at the national level, which is what was just spoken about and in the report on constitutions as well. You have wonderful constitutions, doesn't mean it's necessarily going to, translate into concrete action on the ground. So there's a series of other issues and things that need to happen. I think also, in looking both back and forward, like back on MDGs and forward towards SDGs, making sure that there is a more sort of nuanced implementation happening at the national level. So, the nature of intersecting inequality is so complex that if you don't have a sort of nuanced implementation, it's quite unlikely that you make progress in those areas. So if you look at sort of some of the health goals on the MDGs that required very sort of targeted and kind of vertical interventions like vaccinations and stuff. That was a lot of progress was made there, but much less progress was made, for example, on maternal mortality, which required a more sort of systemic and systematic approach that requires several other issues. So I think that there is obviously hope for the agenda going forward, but I think issues of looking at that kind of nuanced implementation, and probably I think one of the biggest keys is the whole accountability framework that goes with it. The MDGs didn't really have much teeth to them, and I think that if we don't think carefully about accountability for people in general and for marginalized and excluded groups who don't have a voice to begin with, and then if there's no sort of channels for redress when services and when commitments are not lived up to, then it's going to be very hard for this to have a specific action on the ground. I mean, I have a few more thoughts on that, but I think, should I just...
Yeah, no, please go ahead.
I think, you know, if we did want, just touching back on this accountability issue, I think we have an opportunity now looking forward to look at some of the, you know, the world is full of declarations and commitments and agreements, and I think that we need to, you know, we have an opportunity with the SDG framework to look a little bit about how we build on, for example, all the human rights commitments that have already been made. They should be used to look at sort of the targets and the indicators that we think of for the SDG agenda. Like, the countries have already committed to those. Those are more legally binding. So I think that, you know, that is an opportunity to look at, you know, having all the targets and goals be in line with some of the human rights commitments. That at least would make them a little bit more legally binding. I think also that, you know, having those accountability mechanisms, which are more like related to the right to information, access to justice, mm-hmm. like very concrete things that touches a little bit on like how those goals would actually be implemented with a little bit more teeth on them. And then there's a series of policies and programs that have been touched on the report, but there's something else that, you know, I live in Brazil, and we've just had probably the most roller coaster election ever. And so I just, you know, I'm very tempted to just make a comment on something that has come out of these elections that I thought was quite interesting. And it's this kind of maybe cultural or societal resistance to strong social transformations, which I think that Brazil has experienced. So, you know, if you look at, you know, I think that we need to try to instill this idea that greater fairness and greater justice is actually good for all of us. Mm. And that is extremely difficult. So if you look at Brazil, where over the past like 10, 12 years, they've actually taken, there's maybe like about 36 million more people that are now considered, at least statistically, to be in the middle class. And then you come to elections and you have a lot of people who are now against the social project of Brazil because, you know, there was a very revealing piece in one of the newspapers, a columnist in one of the biggest newspapers in Brazil, and she was saying how bothered she was by having bumped into her doorman on the flight to Paris. And how Paris lost its charm because now the doorman is there too. I thought it was quite, I mean, I also laughed like you guys, but I mean, it actually shows a very serious, you know, societal backlash towards having all these people that people think they're better than the others. So then now there's all these people in my space. I bump into them in the airports, you know, in the shops and this and that. So I think that trying to sort of, you know, change that kind of mentality is a huge challenge and hugely important as well. So I think I'll stop there.
Yeah. Thanks very much, Layla. Leandro, any thoughts on just the goal framework issue in terms of what the sustainable development goals can offer to support the kind of processes that you were outlining?
Well, I've never really been a fan of the UN and so less of the MDGs, because I think it sort of, to add to what other people have been saying, it still is thought as what I tell my student, a provider model, mm-hmm. as a top-down, distributive, yes, kind of model in which we're not looking at trying to identify the and create the condition for the marginalized to empower themselves and to provide spaces in which they can participate in policy. Like I said, Brazil has developed that kind of framework, but it still is, the MDGs at least are still thought from that perspective, top-down provider model. It's also understood as a kind of poverty is a is understood within a palliative logic in which you appease something, where the causes come from something else. It's, I think the elephant in the room of the MDGs and the SDGs is the socioeconomic model that we've been adopted for the last 30 years and the international order that goes with it. So neoliberalism. If we actually don't name the beast, we sort of are just playing a game of trying to appease something that actually we can't. We have to sort of provide or at least look at the cases that have been successful and look at how they have actually sort of moved beyond the traditional neoliberal policies and then seek to find ways for other states to have that room of maneuver. So that means structural transformations, reform of the UN, abolish external debt. I can have a huge, beautiful list as beautiful as the MDGs and SDGs, right?
Great. Thanks, Leandro. And a sort of large bucket of cold water in some ways. I think there are some key points in there as well. I think one thing that does shift from the MDGs to the SDGs, though, is the universality principle, because in the sense of, you know, it's not possible to frame this simply as being about north-south resource transfers within a certain relationship, because all countries are engaged in. But anyway, it's yet to be seen if that's delivered. Naila, you kicked off with this critique of the MDG framework. What would be the key things you would think that would need to be different for the SDG or the next framework to have a real effect for the poorest and most marginalised?
I just want to pick up what Leandro says. And, you know, I think it is not the elephant in the room. We talk about it a lot. But the problem is, you know, structural transformation. What's the roadmap, you know? And I think it's that. And so all of us here, and the UN itself, I don't think, is that monolithic. You know, it is, after all, the norm-setting organization in the world, and the one that has managed to give us a human rights framework that we can appeal towards, even though in its other guise, it is the provider, and not terribly efficiently. So to me, I think the issue is always the roadmap. You know, how do we get from here to there? And we need to know what's there, and yes, all, you know, cancel the debt and so on. But I think one thing that has come out of this report for me that has been very important, you could call it politics, but it's also a principle of active engagement and inclusion. So if there is one thing, sometimes that demand for inclusion takes a violent form because of the systematic exclusion of certain people and no hope that you will ever be included. So I think some of the most radical agendas have come about as a result not of a provider model, obviously, but of people just having had enough and mobilizing, whether it's in Brazil, whether it's around indigenous issues, whether it's caste in Nepal, South Africa, and so on. So, but that you cannot have a policy recommendation around. You know, you cannot recommend a revolution or mobilization. But once you have that in place, and B, in order to build that where it doesn't exist, I think there are ways in which the SDGs could be framed that the MDGs were not framed. And I don't, again, know, because of the points that Leandro makes, how realistic we are in asking for this, how realistic we are in asking for a provider model to be displaced by a model of participatory democracy. You know, so how do we take all the policies, programs, constitutions, and build into them the potential for people to engage? And I think the Indian example of using, first of all, the courts through public class action and public interest litigation and so on, to expand the rights that ordinary people have that are not built into the constitution, and then to use policies to build into them the principle of mobilization that people can actually hold the state to account because they have the right to information and there is transparency. So I guess with the SDGs, I'll leave the big goals to other people. But I'm very interested in how does one create the space for active engagement by those people who are most marginalized. And there, I think the issue of gender actually complicates things quite a lot. Because for very marginalized groups, to be a part of that, you have a group identity. And it's quite hard for marginalized women who may suffer greater inequalities in these groups to assert that group identity. So I think when we're talking about active inclusion, we also need to create pathways. And that's where the UN, CEDAW, the international architecture of rights has been very important for people working on the ground. You know, so in Latin America, they have made huge progress in women's land rights because they've been able to invoke the principles of CEDAW. And that has a certain degree of legitimacy. So I think those would be my lessons, in a sense.
That's great, Naila. We've heard a couple of mentions of the Brazil election, but not of the India election. To what extent do you think these things you've talked about, these positive things, rights to information, you know, the constitutional embeddedness of certain processes, do you feel that they are robust enough to survive a major political swing of the kind we saw in India?
Yes, I think they are. I think there's been a real, if you look, a crisis of politics in India between the Congress and, you know, who do ordinary people look to represent their interests? And we don't see anyone very clear. And I think Modi has come in on as presenting himself as somehow a man of the people, right, in a way that the Gandhi dynasty cannot be seen as a man of the people. But I feel, you know, when we talk about India's an imperfect but long-established democracy, I think the threat to India comes less from Modi than from the elephant in the room and the extent to which Modi brings in very strong neoliberal policies. And that may, in a way, disrupt what India has been achieving over the last few years.
Ricardo, what are your hopes, fears, anxieties about the next goal set? Where do you see the potentials and the risks?
Well, I think the potential is in this norm-setting role that the UN plays, because I mean, I think that that's where the UN can have a big influence and on writing a set of objectives that will remain for 15 years, and that people will come back and look at what's written there, at least you know, just as a general guide. That's why it's so exciting that the goal 10 on inequality is there, because I mean, one of the things that happened in the late 70s, early 80s, was that demonization of the conversation of inequality and redistribution. And then for 35 years, we saw this massive concentration of income and wealth that I described before, because we couldn't really talk about it. Yeah. So by having in that kind of like global framework, the topic of inequality, then at least we're allowed to talk about it for the next two decades. And I think it's very important that it remains there. And I think that's something that everyone who cares about this issue should be pushing in different arenas. So that's kind of like the thing that the UN can provide. What cannot provide is the accountability at the national level. Yeah. That comes from local institutions, national citizens, and things like that. So we also need to limit kind of our expectations on what the SDGs can do and cannot do. I agree with Layla that accountability is key. And I think there are two processes happening right now that push in different directions. One is this kind of constitutional reforms and things like that, the way India is experiencing it. But at the same time, there's a lot of corruption in India. And there's a growing wealth coming from rent extracting sectors. And the question is, who's going to win? You know, when these things come tête-à-tête, when there's a contestation of power between the rent-extracting billionaires or the marginalized groups demanding their rights, who will have a stronger voice? And I think we shouldn't I mean, we shouldn't forget that, yeah, there's progress in these constitutional reforms and programs that enhance the rights of the marginalized groups, but at the same time, if that is accompanied by a redistribution of power and influence to the most affluent members of society, then it's likely that it's not going to end up well. So I think again, norm setting is very important, and I think it's something that the SDGs can contribute to the long term agenda. But I think change will happen at the national level, and the question is, what are the minimum conditions that are required for this change to occur? And again, the civil society space and elements of accountability are very important.
Great, thanks very much. Does anyone else on the panel have anything burning to say now before I open it
Could
up?
I? Yeah, go ahead. I just want to add to the issue of India. I think we also have to, although India hasn't made the kind of progress that we've seen in the Latin American countries, it has made a considerable amount of progress, and the National Employment Guarantee Scheme, etc., are a response to what we often forget, that a large part of India has been subject to low-level insurgency and conflict of various kinds. And a lot of this conflict draws on the most marginalized groups. So although, as the Indian government report says, not all Dalits join the Naxalites are disproportionately drawn from the Dalit groups. So India hasn't sorted out its issues.
I just want to make that one point on universality. I mean, I think the universality principle is really important, and linking back to Naila's point. I mean, you know, setting norms about universality is a really, really important thing to do, both at a global level and also thinking about that at a national level as well. And so within DFID, we're delighted to see that sort of universality coming through the SDGs, including on health coverage, and thinking that through is really important, because that gives one, not the only, but one of the platforms around which people can organise and start to claim some of their rights around that. That needs to be set within constitutional reforms and legislation, clearly, and political settlements underpin it. But it's a pretty important global message, actually, to say there are some universal standards to which we think no one should fall below. And that clarion political call can then operate in some of the spaces around civil society going forward.
That's really good to hear. I think one of the question marks, obviously, about high-level panel report was about universal health coverage. So, I mean, it's great to hear that there's that kind of support at this point. I must admit, one of the things that is not clear to me is how the global goals get translated into national targets, how that finds its way through into planning frameworks and so on and so forth. And clearly a lot of this stuff does need to, can't be simply laid out in the way the SDGs were, as some sort of global meta frame of data. So anyway, but at this point, if everyone's comfortable on the panel that they've said what they wanted to say for the opening, I'd like to open up. And I've got some kind of steering questions, but I'll just leave them for now because the discussion's in an interesting place. So if anyone wants to come in at where we are, we've got three questions over there. Let's take those to start with and then move along.